chapter 4. If you head that way, please. We'll continue on this morning in Hebrews 4. Amen. Just a little recap of last week. We're looking at the warning of missing God's rest, that even today in 2023 you can miss His rest. His rest is not salvation. It's not eternity with Him. His rest is what He gives you right now in this life to rest against warring with sin, to rest against warring with all trials and tribulation, but being overcomers of those. And so every believer in this house, every believer in this room, has the ability to overcome, not in our flesh, but by the power of the Holy Spirit in us. Amen? By the power of God living in us, we have the ability to overcome sin, be more than overcomers, and we'll come to that verse in Romans 8 in just a minute, but to live victorious lives. And you may be thinking, boy, my life is not very victorious, hadn't been for a while, then maybe you need to check in with God, see what's going on, right? Because He wants us to have that victorious. Doesn't mean you're not going to have trials and tribulations. Don't get me wrong. It's not going to be a smooth road. We all are following a narrow path. We're not following the wide road of destruction. We're following a narrow path when we come to Christ, and that narrow path is treacherous. It has rocks, it has cliffs, it has everything in it. That have to deal with the problems in life. But we don't face those problems alone. We don't go into those problems without Christ uplifting us, amen, and empowering us to beat that problem, whatever it may be. You may have a sin issue in your life. You say, I can't stop this, I can't stop this. That's exactly where God wants you to be, to say, God, I can't stop this. That's where I want you. Now I can stop it through you. It's all about Him, folks. It's all about Christ. When we're looking at the rest that God has given us. So, looking in chapter 4 again, a Sabbath rest for the people of God, or a rest for the people of God. I'm going to read all 13 verses again, and we'll go back and start breaking down. Therefore, since the promise of entering His rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. For we have also have believed the gospel preached to us, just as you did, but the message they heard was of no value to them, because those who heard it did not combine it with faith. Now we who have believed enter that rest just as God has said. So I declare on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. And yet His work has been finished since the creation of the world. For somewhere He has spoken about the seventh day in those words, and on the seventh day God rested from all His work. And again in the passage above He says, they shall never enter my rest. It still remains that some will enter that rest, and those who formerly had the gospel preached to them did not go in because of their disobedience. Therefore, God, again, set a certain day, calling it today. Then when a long time later He spoke through David, as was said before, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would have not spoken later about another day. There remains then a Sabbath rest for God's people. For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from his own work, just as God did from His. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest so that no one will fall by following the example of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. Now, last week I started out and I came across the rest, the kinds of rest that we will get, and one of them, recapping a little bit here, one of them is the rest of satisfaction, pleasure with one's work, pleasure with doing the work that God has given us to do while we're still here. Everybody in this congregation is employed by Almighty God. Amen, right? You're employed. As long as you're living here, you never retire from His employment. Get that now, because we in America love to retire, don't we, right? We do not retire from God's employment, what God has given us to do. The day we retire is the day we take our last breath and He brings us home, all right? We need to understand that we are never retired from telling the gospel message to the world. As long as we walk, as long as we have breath in us, we will proclaim His name outside these walls and inside these walls, amen, church? And say who He is and speak truth against lie, bring light into darkness. That is our job. That is what we're employed for. You want to know what your job description is? Go and make disciples. That's exactly what it is. Go and make disciples of Jesus Christ, teaching them to observe all things He's taught us, all things we know about Him, teaching them to observe the same things. Maybe, just hopefully, they'll come to salvation by us speaking to them about God. But that mandate is already upon us to do that. And he gave it to his disciples in Matthew 28, but he also gave it to us in 2023. Go make disciples. Go and make more disciples of Jesus Christ. More that will follow him. Not disciples of your denomination, not disciples of your Baptist church, but make disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen? We need to understand Jesus wasn't a Catholic or a Baptist or a this or a that. He was God. Amen? So you need to understand that. It's not about a certain group of people. It's about one man, Jesus Christ. So the other kind of rest we have is not only that, we have a rest in our salvation. A rest, if you will, in a deliverance and salvation. Now before you got saved, before you gave your life to Christ, you had no chance of deliverance and no chance of salvation, did you? It's not built up on what we can do about it. And after we get saved, we need to stop trying to get saved more. It doesn't work that way. You are saved. It's a fact. It's over. It's done. Now comes the sanctification process. Now comes walking that tight, narrow path of righteousness and holiness before God. It's a lifestyle thing, isn't it, church? The minute you get saved, that's when it begins, your salvation. That's when all of it starts. We have a salvation in us that looks forward to that day when all of this stuff is done. All of this is over. And we're in a glorified state. We are now no longer affected whatsoever with sin, sinful thoughts, sinful ways, a dying body. Amen. I know that feeling, right? Falling apart on us, folks, right? We no longer have to deal with that. We're in a glorified state. So therefore, we have been delivered from this world, this sinful world, the sin and the nature of this world, the temptation of this world. You'll be delivered from that, no longer affecting you in your glorified state, in that deliverance. But right now, we are in the midst of it, but we, again, I go back to the word, conquer over it. We conquer it. We don't have to bow down to it. We don't have to sin. We don't have to do these things like we used to. Because used to, when you before you were saved, you had no power to get away from it. It was in you. It was around you. It was on you. But now, with God in us, greater is he that's in us than what? He that's in the world, the whole world. Greater is he that's in us. Who's in us? Jesus Christ. How? By the Holy Spirit, right? We know Jesus is seated at the right hand of God right now, waiting on the Father to say, Son, he's ever interceding for us. He's still working, folks. Remember that. God is still working. Jesus is still working. When this verse said God sat down and had a rest, it meant he had finished creation. It was completed. And he sat back and he took a rest. He was glad of what he made. Everything was absolutely perfect. Think about that, folks. Creation. Everything was absolutely perfect. Adam, Eve were absolutely perfect, weren't they? They had no sin problems. They had nothing of sin, nothing. The whole creation was just, it's hard to even think of how what it looked like, right? Because we look at a world broken down by sin. We look at a world that's polluted with sin and problems, and we don't see the creation that God actually made, what it really looked like, how awesome it must have been. And Adam and Eve are stuck right there in the middle of that garden, right in the middle of all the beauty of it, and there's no antagonism. There's no anger. There's no anything going. It's all harmony. It's all God. Until when? Satan come along and deceived Eve. And the minute he deceived her, she stopped believing what God said and believed his lie. And when she did, here we are today, right? When Adam was with her, I know he did the same thing. But the point being is that when they did that, that's why we're in this situation. I'm sorry to say, but the situation we're in now in this world. It's ruled by the prince of darkness. It is his world, folks. Amen? But it's soon to be God's again. Amen? God's in control of it. He's in control of what's going on. But there's soon coming a day when Satan will no longer rule the prince of the air. He'll be locked away for 1,000 years. And God's kingdom, God's reign, will be all over this earth, all over this world. We look forward to that. We call it the millennial reign. We look forward to that. So there's a deliverance and salvation. The children of Israel, the people that he's actually talking about here, the Hebrew children, had just come out of slavery. Their food was not the greatest. It was leeks and onion and all kinds of not really good stuff. It was their food, their diet while they were slaves in Egypt. Notice the difference in what's happening here. When they come to Jordan River, when they're looking at Canaan, when they're looking at their rest that God has given, their blessing that God's about to give them, Canaan is not heaven. Don't get it mixed up with heaven. Canaan is their blessing. It's their rest from what? Where they've been the last 400 years? Slavery. And what is the first thing they notice when the spies go over into Canaan? It's a land flowing with what? Milk and honey, isn't it? You know what that means? It's very fruitful. It takes two guys to haul around a group of grapes because they're so huge, they're so bountiful, they're so awesome looking, right? Food is bountiful, and they've been living off of onions and leeks, whatever a leek is. They've been living off of that for 400-something years. Now all of a sudden they got all of this food available to them. It's God's blessing to his nation. They still have to believe and walk. What's the problem with their belief? There's giants over there. That's a lot of food, a lot of stuff going on, beautiful land, beautiful greenery, all this kind of stuff, but we got a problem. There's some giants over there. And what happened to them? They cowered down, didn't they? Why? Because they didn't believe God. Who did? Joshua and Caleb. 2 out of 12 said, we can take it, man. Got to give it to us. Got to give it to us. The rest are like, no, we look like ants in their sight. We need to hold off on this. They disobeyed. They didn't believe God, and they did not cross over. You know the story. What happened? 40 years of what? Playing in the dirt, right? Out there in the desert. Not the land flowing with milk and honey, but this dry, barren place. You can look at that story and you can see that even in 2023, Christian, you can end up in the same place. If you don't believe and follow God, if you're disobedient to Him, you will wander around in a spiritual desert. And most of us think that's normal because it's where we've been all our life. We have never really crossed over into that promise of what God is getting. What? The abundant life, right? I'm not talking about money in your pocket. I'm talking about the abundant life in here and in here. It's a spiritual aspect, not a physical aspect. The abundant life. And many people are not walking it because they're still wandering in their desert. They have not understood that they have been delivered from that and that God has said, come on in, let me show you some things. I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. I own the warehouse, y'all. Come on in, right? There's plenty of food. There's plenty of supplies. There's plenty of everything for you. And we stand outside the gate and go, well, I think I can handle this on my own in my flesh. And that's where we stay. We don't step in. We do not step into His provision, if you will. Israel did the same thing. They did not believe. They stayed outside. They did not get delivered into it. Israel's abundance was in bondage. And the result of their sin was staying in the desert. It's not a type of how we go through trials and tribulations. That's our desert. No, you're in the desert because you sin. Let's just get down to it, right? You stay in the desert because you sin, not because you're going through trials. Yeah, you're going to go through trials, but you go through trials and tribulations living the abundant life too, right? But you understand who you are. You understand why the trials are coming. You understand what's going on. You say, God is in charge. He's my God. I'll go through it. I won't go around it. I won't go under it. I won't go over it. I'm going through the mountain. I'm going through whatever He's laid in front of me. And there's a reason it's there. All of us would not go through the same temptation or the same trials. Y'all know that, right? You're on your own path. You're on your own path of sanctification, not towards salvation, but sanctification. There's only one path to salvation. That's through Jesus Christ. We need to make sure everybody in the world understands that. There's only one way to salvation through Jesus Christ. But each and every one of us in our sanctification process after we got saved will run into different things. We're not going to all run into the same thing. We may run into somebody that has gone through what we're going through and they can help minister to us at the same time. Whether it be a sickness like cancer or something like that, they've gone through. God is faithful. Just trust God and keep walking. Trust God and keep walking, right? We get encouraged from those people who've gone through those trials before, but all of us aren't going through that same trial. Some of us in this room never will have cancer, right? I'm not naming it and claiming it here. I'm just telling you. Some of us will never face cancer. But there will be some that do, and there will be other Christians that come along and will, and the person that has faced it and God has brought them through will be able to minister to them much better than us who've never had it and don't know what we're talking about, right? Absolutely. Absolutely. So we need to understand why those things come to us like that. We need to understand what these people did, how they disobeyed, they stayed in the desert. And then it's interesting as he talks about here, the future. He talks about there's a rest of a new day. Now, if God had given Israel, I think what's happening here in the church in the Hebrews, the Hebrew writer is talking to this church about, is they think they've missed God's rest. They think they've missed His salvation. Remember, this is first century church. They've just killed Jesus probably 50 days ago or whatever, you know, in that years maybe ago. And it's all fresh and it's all new, and the people are thinking, oh, we've missed God's salvation, we've missed His rest. And the writer here is trying to get them to understand, no. It didn't pass. Joshua didn't give it to them way back then either. It's still today. You know what that's saying? In 2023, it's still today. Because in this situation, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit, but in this situation where he talks about that God says there'll be another day, he's talking to King David. He's talking to David 500 years later when he gives him the scripture in Psalms and says, today is the day of salvation. If you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as we did in the what? Past. He's saying today's still the day. So in 2023, guess what? Today is the day salvation, isn't it? It still is. We're in that age. We're still in that age of grace, in that age of salvation being brought to us, the rest of God being brought to us for all who will believe. But notice what the scripture said. God says on oath, those who do not believe will not enter into what? Rest or salvation. Simple as that. It's as simple as that. What are the two kinds of people in the world? Believers and non-believers. As far as God's concerned, he don't look at skin color. He don't look at race. He don't look at nationality. He looks at believers and non-believers. Two different people. That's it. Two people. Believer or non-believer. Which one are you? You just a churchgoer or are you a real believer? Are you in all in? As I call all in. You're totally in. Trusting in Jesus Christ. Trusting in God for your salvation here and now. Your rest here and now. And your salvation, your rest there and yonder. Right? We're trusting. We're believing. And that belief puts us into action. So he says there's going to be a new day. What are we resting from in the future, in that future day? Right now, we are in warfare. Right now, we wrestle with the flesh. We wrestle with sin issues. We wrestle with all. In that great and glorious day, in the future day, right, when we have been glorified, when we have been taken out of this body, taken and glorified for God for eternity, we, first of all, when we take our last breath here, we will no longer wrestle with sin, right? We'll no longer wrestle with the enemy, wrestling with powers and principalities. That's for here and now. We'll no longer wrestle with, we will no longer have those battles going, those fights going on. We'll no longer wrestle with death. Jesus has what? Been victorious over death, actual physical death. We won't worry about that anymore. We'll be done with that. We'll be done with that. So we will enter into a rest in the future when that new day comes. Revelation 14:13 says this, said, I heard a voice from heaven say, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labor, for their deeds will follow them. Did you hear that verse? When is our labor? Right here now. Right here now. We labor. We work for God. We're on his employment line, if you will. We work for him now. There's coming a day when this labor will be over with. Telling the gospel, giving a cold cup of water, ministering to people out there, doing whatever we can do here and now, whatever he lines up for us to do. Those days will be over, but notice the last part of that. What did it say? Their works will what? Follow them, won't it? Are you storing up treasures in heaven? What kind of works are going to follow you? Is it going to be works that you've done so that you can get a pat on the back or recognition? I mean, look, folks, I've run into a lot of folks in church that if you don't recognize them, woo, look out, right? For the slightest little thing, like even picking up a piece of paper off the floor, recognize me, look at me, look. Oh, boy. I can tell you right now, that person has no treasures in heaven. They're getting their treasure right here. The scripture, Jesus strictly warned us about that. If you get it here, it won't be there. Don't let your left hand know what your right hand's doing type thing, right? It's one of those things where you don't go out and glorify yourself about what you've done. I think Jesus was talking about the Pharisees standing on the corner and praying in all their glory. And Jesus told him, said, yeah, he's already got his reward. But that dude over there beating his chest, that sinner, talking about how sinful, he's got a reward coming that nobody ever sees, that nobody will see until glory is revealed. So we need to understand that's what that verse said. Their deeds will follow them to that great judgment in heaven. In verse 2, we see here, we've also had the gospel preached to us just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value. Why? Because those who heard it did not combine it with faith. How do you get saved? For it is by grace that we are saved through what? Faith. You can't leave faith out of salvation. You know, it's what the book of James is about. James, in his book, well, one chapter anyway, he's talking about, you say you got faith, I say I got works. You show me your faith without works, I'll show you a dead faith, right? He's not promoting that we have to do works to prove our faith. We do works because we have faith, right? That's the whole thing about James. He said, I'll show you, and my works are no good unless I back them up with what? Faith. He's comparing the two, and he's swapping them around like this to let you understand something. that you cannot operate in the kingdom of God in any way without operating in faith. See, I can believe that this table will hold me up, right? I can look at the structure of it and say, yeah, I think it'll handle about 230. Yeah, I think that table will hold me. How am I going to know, though? I can talk about it and talk about it and talk about it until I'm blue in the face, but until I sit on it, until I get on the table, I'm not operating in faith. I'm operating in some facts. I'm operating in some news that somebody told me about this, you know, but I'm not operating in it. Let me tell you something about your Christian walk, folks. You can say, I believe in Jesus. Well, the devils believe and they tremble too, right? I believe in Jesus. I believe in the church. I believe in what God, I believe God's in control. I believe, but have you placed yourself on him? You see? Jesus is like that table. Unless you put yourself in Christ, unless you truly trust in him, not just for your future and for your ever after, but for right now, you're not operating in faith. You see, we've got a bad definition of faith here with some of the stuff we see happening in the world today, and mostly in the healing business, you might say. Oh, you don't have any faith. Well, No. Your faith is how you live every day. Your faith is getting up in the morning and say, okay, Lord, let's go. Let's get with it. I know you're in charge. Let's go. Let's do this. What do you have in store today? That's faith that he's in charge. That's faith that you are operating in his kingdom, right? Not that I talk about his kingdom. Not that I go study about his kingdom or listen to somebody else preach about his kingdom or this or that. I operate in the kingdom. I move. In him we move and live and have our what? Being, right? We're in his kingdom. We're operating in the kingdom. Or we're not living by faith. We're just living in the desert. One or the other. But what he says here in verse 2, he says, you know what? It was preached to them. Israel knew what was coming. Israel knew it, saw it. They looked across the river and they saw the promise of God right there. But they didn't have the faith to step off in the water and go across. Just two of them did. And for 40 years, those two boys had to watch everybody die that did not believe. Their bones, as the scripture says, were scattered all over that desert for 40 years waiting. And then one day when it was done, when it was time on God's timetable, Joshua said, let's get them up. Let's get them together. We're going over. Now, was that land easy to take? No. It's because, again, Canaan's not heaven. It's not heaven. It's not paid for. They had to go in and fight for it from their own. I don't know if they'd walked across back then, if they would not have had to fight, God would have just scattered their enemies for them, or if they'd have had to battle. But now, 40 years later, they're going to take the land. God's still giving it to them, but there's going to be bloodshed getting it. There's going to be some bloodshed having to take place to get it. So we see here that these folks are dealing with that in verse 2. They heard it. It was no value because they heard it, didn't combine it with faith. In verse 3, we have believed. We who have believed, now notice that, have entered that rest. The same type of rest that was given to the Hebrews, the Canaan rest. We rest in Jesus Christ. Jesus said, come to me who are what? All weary and heavy laden, I'll give you what? Rest. Not heaven. Rest. I will give you rest. Which means we operate in that right now. And rest is not doing nothing, which we sometimes tend to think. We just kick back in our recliner. That's our rest, you know. That may be temporary rest. Rest is not doing anything. When God rested after creating the heavens and the earth and mankind, and on the seventh day he rested, it meant he rested because it was completed. God is still active, isn't he? He went right back to work, didn't he? After he had his rest, after his seventh day, he went right back to work. God is active and he's working even today in this world right now through me and you and by himself. Amen. He's still actively working and doing things. Jesus Christ, seated at the right hand of God. He is resting from what? For giving salvation, for completing it for us. When he had finished, and when it was finished, and God, and he rose from the earth back to heaven and seated at the right hand of God, he was finished, so he sat down and rested from what? Offering salvation, paying the price. Lamb of God for salvation. Is Jesus just sitting in his rocker waiting? No. He's ever interceding for it means he's still working. He's still working. He's still working today through me and you, the church. Now get this. He's alive, isn't he? Where? In us. He's alive, isn't he? Where? In us. We are what? His what? Body, right? If we're his body, then what's his body doing? Should be doing some work while the body's still here on earth. There's coming a day when he's going to take the body up. Amen? That work will be over. That age will be shut down, cut off. We're living in the age right now, the age of grace, the age of sending the message out there, the age of mercy, the age of... If we got what we deserve, folks, you know what would be coming. But his grace is upon us. His mercy is upon us. And not only that, his Spirit is within us, the body of Christ, to do what? Continue the work that Jesus was doing when he walked this earth, bringing salvation to men, telling them the good news, bringing salvation to everybody, our enemy. Talked about that, I think, last week or week before. Even those we hate, bringing the message of love and salvation to them. The hardest people you'll ever touch, right? Most of us don't want to go up to people we hate or that hate us and tell them the good news. It might have been a Wednesday night. Many of us may be thinking, you know, I don't want to tell them. I don't just let them go where they're supposed to go. I don't even want them to be in heaven with me. You know, you get that attitude going. You better be careful, right? But we can get that attitude with people. But we are to tell everybody about that. We're to tell everybody about that. The Hebrew children saw the giants. They didn't want to go in. No way. Verse 3 said, we can come short of that. If you look in 3, he said, now we believe and enter that rest just as God said. So I declare on an oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. He's not talking to us who believe. He's talking to all who disbelieve, who do not believe in him, who do not believe in his salvation. He's talking to the Hebrew children who disobeyed and didn't cross over when he said, come, take it, take the land, flowing with milk and honey. He said, they will never enter my... Did they ever enter the rest? No. They stayed in the desert, didn't they? They wandered in the desert, never experiencing God's rest, never experiencing his blessing of abundance that he was giving them in Canaan. They died out there in that desert. Their children crossed over. That next generation crossed over. Joshua and Caleb, they were in their 80s, or around 80 years of age when they finally crossed over. And they took the sword and killed people. They were still battle-worthy, all right? I think, man, when I'm 80, I'd probably be able to pick the sword up. It's like, what, you know, but these guys were as strong as they were 40 years ago, and they were ready to go in and take the land. God had sustained them boys, didn't he? He sustained them. Even at 80 years of age, they were able to lead the army into battle. You realize, and if you read the story, it's a really interesting story. Go back and look at it. You know which land Caleb decided he wanted to take? The land where the giants were. Isn't that interesting? He's the giant killer, man. Caleb's like, I want to take that land over toward Philistia down there. I want to go that way. Who else came out of Philistine area, right? David and who? Goliath, right? Goliath came from that area of Gad and Goth or whatever they call it. That's who Caleb said. Caleb, hey Josh, can I have that spot over there? I want that spot over there. I want to go get the giants. And he took his crew with him, and they went and slew giants, folks. He had no fear whatsoever. Go back and read his story. You'll see. He said, I want to take that land in this direction. Joshua even gave him a choice. Said, which land? Where are you going to go? I'm going to go that way. I want those giants. I want them big jokers. I want them. God's going to give them to me. I want them. Yeah, what a warrior. 80-year-old guy, right? He's ready to go fight. Unbelievers shall not enter his rest, as he says right here. And yet his work has been finished since the creation of the world. Jesus, God has finished his work. And then he spoke that to them, that they will not enter my rest. That verse also applies to today. Anyone who does not believe, anyone who rejects salvation from Jesus Christ, anyone who does not believe God's word, the Bible, the work of God, the word of God, will not enter into that rest. Not only here and now, but also that eternal rest. That eternal rest. As far as I can see in the scripture, that is one of the most unforgivable sins there is. Disbelief. Rejecting God's salvation. Nobody is ever forgiven for rejecting Jesus Christ. Ouch, right? God draws a hard line there, doesn't it? You will not enter in if you reject my son. You will not enter into my kingdom or into eternal rest if you do not follow my son. You do not give your life to my son, to our Messiah, our Savior, right? Who do we come to when we want to get saved? Jesus himself. We thank God for his son. We confess our sin to God, his son, and God. They're both God. We confess our sin. We ask for forgiveness of those sins. That if you shall confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, what? You shall be saved, right? Not if you join the Baptist church or the Catholic or this church or that church. If you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, there's that word belief again, isn't it? If we think it's a fable, if we think this is a bunch of wild stories, then you don't believe. You don't have faith that it's real. I can tell you right now, when I read this scripture, I have faith to believe that every one of those stories in there is real. Jonah and the big fish, oh yeah. It don't make sense logically or medically that he's going to live 3 days in the belly of a fish in the bottom of the sea, right? No way he can live. Let me tell you something. God can sustain you if he wants to through whatever you want to go through. Whatever you have to go. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Are we fireproof? No. But those boys were that day, weren't they? They thrown in the fiery furnace. Didn't even get a burn on them. The only thing that burned off was what? That which bound them. The ropes. Nebuchadnezzar's watching that going, oh my goodness, who's in there with him? Who's that fourth one? You know who it was? Jesus. He appeared in the fire with them. It don't make common sense, does it? They're thrown into a fire, then they don't even melt down. They don't even get burned. God will sustain us through whatever we have to go through, whatever this world wants to throw us into. If he wants us to remain alive, we will be sustained by his mighty power and his hand. You understand that, right? Hadn't changed. Same God. Same God that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego bowed down to and would not bow down to King Nebuchadnezzar and Daniel too. Same God we serve today. He hasn't changed. He will sustain. And if he doesn't, like those three boys said, O King, if he chooses not to, we're still not going to bow down to you. He wants to take our life, so be it. They understood his providence, didn't they? They understood who God was. If he chooses to take it, you're just sending us to heaven, Nebuchadnezzar. You're not killing us. They knew that. They knew that. We're thrown in there. It didn't even get burned. Come on. Really? Yeah, I believe that. I believe that story. I believe Daniel thrown down in the midst of a bunch of lions that were hungry as all get out, didn't get a scratch on him. Why? Because God covered him. God covered him in the midst of where a man cannot do that kind of stuff and walk into a lion's den and not get ripped to pieces. I believe that story with all my heart. Why? Because I have faith that God says it happened. That's the way it will. That's the way it happened. Exactly the way it happened. Look at the story. What happens? Daniel's thrown down. King Darius, he's crazy all night thinking, oh, my good friend, my good prophet friend, and my good Hebrew friend, he's going to be torn all to pieces by these lions because we have trained them to kill, right? All night, he can't hardly sleep until the next day. He comes back and says, Daniel, you okay? Daniel's like, I live forever, King. I'm fine. Don't worry about me. What happens the next time in that, very next thing in that story? The king went and got the people who claimed or blamed him or pointed out that Daniel was bowing down to his God. He went and got those people who accused him, threw them in the pit, and what happens? Before they hit the floor, they're ripped into pieces. You don't think God didn't have his hand on Daniel? You don't think the God that we serve wasn't moving on his prophet, keeping those lions' mouths shut? I mean, come on, look at that picture, folks. Look at that picture. Look real close. And then look today where we are. You don't think God's not got you covered? This world wants you dead, folks. The enemy wants you gone. You can't see what's happening. There's warfare going on, folks. And God's got you covered. As the psalm says, like a mother hen with her wings over her babies. Y'all see that picture? That's like God over us. His protection, his providence over us as a people, we cannot see what's happening, but I guarantee you, folks, we are covered. And if he decides not to cover us, we fear nothing. We don't fear death. Why? Jesus has paid the price. Jesus has overcome, so therefore I, who follow Jesus, have overcome. It don't affect us like it used to, does it? We shouldn't even have a fear of death at all in our bone, any part of our body. Because what it means to us is what? We get to step across at that point. We step on over into glory, believer. This thing is over. And we step into his presence. The veil is ripped open. We see clearly. You're looking at me, because I know you've had loved ones that have gone before you, and you know they're saved. And you have an idea of what they're looking at right now. And it makes your heart race, doesn't it? Because you're thinking, oh, man. He's already there. He already sees this, and I know it's coming. Why? Because I have faith in what this book says right here, the Word of God, that what is in store for us, what's coming for us. And I also have faith to know what's in store for those we're not witnessing to, for those who do not know Him, the hell that's coming their way, right? Let your heart bleed for them, folks. Have compassion on them, because there's coming a day when this age is going to stop and they won't have another chance. They won't have a chance. But today, as the Scripture says, today is the day. If you get a chance, tell somebody. Tell somebody. Time is short. Be urgent about it. The bridge is out, folks. You need to let them know, right? Tell them. Be bold. Be strong. And go after them. We're still here, and as long as we have a breath in our bodies, we are to make disciples. We're to bring people to the kingdom of God. Even if it's just planting the seed or closing the deal, God only the one that closes the deal. You know that. We are involved in that whole process. We need to be involved in that process. We'll have to stop right here. Woo, got another one left in this one. But anyway, I want to encourage you with that, folks, that you who have believed, you are in His rest. If you're not experiencing His rest, search your soul and find out what's going on. Amen? That's the only thing I can tell you. I can't tell what's in your heart. I can't tell what's in your soul, but I guarantee you the Word of God can. Matter of fact, it talks about rightly dividing. It divides like a sword. It cuts through and divides, right? God knows exactly what's in your heart. You're not hiding it from Him. And I'm speaking to myself too, right? We're not hiding it from Him. He knows all of it. If we know what's going on, let's clean it up. Let's straighten it out, right? Go to Him. He's graceful. He's merciful, folks. He's not going to slap you. Amen. He's going to wrap His arms around you. Say, welcome home, son, daughter. Welcome home. Been waiting on you. Come on, let's get out of this sandy pit and let's get over here in this abundant life. What do you say? Right? Repent. Repent and go to Him. That's all the Scripture's telling us to do. And repentance is not for God. It's for who? It's us, isn't it? God already knows. Repentance is what sets us free. Coming to Him with our sin. Coming to Him with what we're doing. And saying, God, I can't stop. I can't defeat that. I can't defeat this. I can't stop this. And He said, that's right. That's right where I want you. Watch what I do. Release. Surrender. Watch this. Right? Watch this. Let me pray for you guys and let you go. Thank you for being here today. Hope you have a great week. Pray for VBS. We'll have a lot of children in here. There may be a few of them that may not be saved, and we need to be able to present the gospel to them. Their ears will hear, and their eyes will see throughout this week as we present Jesus to them through VBS. All right, so pray for that every day, every evening, like Bud said, around 6 o'clock, start praying for it, and let God do what God's going to do. Amen. Amen. Let me pray for you and let you guys go. Our God, you reign.